We're here with Katie INNAMORATO, who is a taxidermy artist, and Anna Goldman, Mammals Prep Lab Manager, and me. Today we're going to learn how to taxidermy some squirrels. You're a taxidermist, mm-hmm. Katie. How is that different from what Anna does?
So when you're doing taxidermy, there's just a couple extra steps you have to go in. It's a little bit more prep work. We have to go in, we have to split your lips, you have to split your eyelids, you have to turn your ears inside out, you have to go all the way down to the last knuckle on each of your toes. So it's just a little bit more tedious to prep your hide properly so that you can tuck it on your form later.
What I do is just around a cotton form with wires in the hand and wires in the tail. It's much more simplistic, it dries naturally, and it's really just so scientists can look at it and identify color patterns, fur thickness, different locality data, that kind of stuff. So it's got nothing to do with these guys.
Ultimately, like, the difference between a taxidermy mount and a museum study mount is that the museum studies are going to be used for research, yeah. and the taxidermy things are, you are literally trying to breathe life back yep. into the shape of yeah. the animal.
Yep.
Like, you're giving it fake eyeballs, mm-hmm. you're giving it a realistic pose.
Body shape, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Step number one, find some dead squirrels.
Yep.
Where did these guys come from?
These guys are all from roadkill, so they're have a little bit of trauma going on.
They've yeah. had some concrete surgery done to them.
Anna's has his intestines blowing out of its leg.
We have an intestinal pocket in the leg that we can just keep going and going.
Oh, that's disgusting.
We'll just put that back in there yeah. for you.
But the squirrels are okay. Yep. I mean, they're not. Okay. They're really messed up.
This is not okay. this is just not okay.
His jaw, his mandible is in the outside of his face.
All of them have that going on too.
Yeah. Wow. That guy. That makes my mouth hurt. Yeah. So anyway, we're gonna breathe some life back into these critters.
So first step is I like to have the specimen facing me. Because you always want to try to cut with the direction of the fur.
Okay.
And these guys have some long fur, so what we want to try to do is make a little bit of a seam so that we don't end up cutting any fur, so we can use our fingers. Otherwise, I have wire brushes. We can use those to just help part our fur.
Automatically, this is a little bit different than what I've ever done.
We are being a lot nicer typically to the specimen. I mean, not that we're like totally mean or terrible, but mostly we take our measurements and then we just slice the belly. So we kind of start on the other side. We probably start here because when we make our stitches, it's belly side down for our study skins. So we don't want the stitch to be as visible, but also color pattern up here is really important and a lot more distinctive. So stitching there may skew with the data, so to say. The spine is totally shattered, so my line is a little crooked.
Yeah, that's fine. So I like to start my incision. I'm not sure how you guys usually do it. I hold the blade upside down, I just do a puncture, and then I just kind of slide the blade up from the underside of the skin.
This is totally different.
So you're crazy. That's
so
madness.
So you don't cut the fur. That's the big thing. So you're just kind of gently wiggling the blade around under the skin to cut it.
So normally what we would do is not hold... this is literally everything is doing backwards. Instead of going on the belly with the blade like this, we're going on the back with the blade like this.
I feel like I'm using my left hand.
Really?
I feel like I'm learning...
I feel like I'm learning.
No, that came out weird. Yeah. Oh, his brains are coming out of the back of his head.
And now we can just start peeling the skin down the back.
So where are we at with these guys now, Anna? How is your squirrel looking over there?
You can see... this is the femur, and the pelvis is totally shattered. So the pelvis would be right here. And yeah, that is actually completely split. So the pelvis is there, and these are the guts. My fingers now in the guts.
So what do we need to do in order to actually mount these guys?
For taxidermy purposes, you only use the skin. And that's something that a lot of people are not aware of or kind of get confused with. Old school taxidermists, they would use the bones, they would clean them and add wire to them for more structure, and they'd make armatures using the skeletons that way. But commercial guys and traditional guys nowadays buy commercially made forms, so you only need to use the skin. So let's see if we can get this to go.
Cool.
I like to cradle the back end as much as I can, just so I have a firm grip on the animal.
Mm-hmm.
And get that meat off my hands. I like to use my index finger for support underneath.
Mm-hmm.
And then I use my thumb and my thumbnail to kind of get in here and just slide it. So my guy was easier than yours.
Oh,
Got it. So just grab it with a dry paper towel.
This is his tail that pulled off of his body. It wasn't attached very well anyway. Oh, there we go.
Perfect.
So fleshing just basically involves taking a pair of tweezers or one of these wire brushes and getting the tissue off of the skin, right?
Yep, and when I'm at home, I have a fleshing beam. So it's just a piece of wood at a 45-degree angle that I set the skin on. And same thing with the blade. It's about a 45-degree angle. You just want to get in here under the muscle and you just scrape it off.
And so for the tanning process, you know, my idea is that we have these huge tanning wheels out over there, and I imagine like this going into some kind of version of a dryer or something. But that's not how you tan the skins that we're going to transition to.
Yeah, for these guys, I just mix up a tanning solution. The one I use has a mix of formic acid and a couple other different chemicals, so they're really harsh.
So basically, the skins go into a chemical tan, and then we get these guys.
Yep, these guys right here. So they're completely tanned already, and we just have to go and finish prepping them.
So we kind of cheated a little bit, and then we have ones that were already ready for the sake of it's like the brownie.
For like 5 days, you know?
Yeah, it's like the brownies in the cooking show, where you're just like, here's the batter in, here's the brownies.
I'm really glad you said something, because I brought a change of clothes. 5 days later!
Oh yeah, movie magic. All right. So you have these forms, and I can't imagine this is what Carl Akeley used for his taxidermy. So what are these forms? Where can you buy them? And how are they different than like using the actual skeleton parts?
Okay, so these guys are made of a high-density urethane foam, and they just are popped out of molds. And they come from different taxidermy supply companies.
Anna and I have the same one.
Yeah,
but
your
not
squirrels,
all squirrels
are smaller, and I don't know what's going on with this big guy, but he's just huge.
It's just crazy to think about replicating veins and like muscle structure with that.
Yeah, we just want to rough it up, try to remove
rough
the lines on here, go around the face with the modeling tool or with the scalpel. I can give you the modeling tool when I'm done with it. I'll just use this guy for an example. You want to follow along that lip line that's already on your form, and you want to go in about like a quarter of an inch deep or so. And this is our little relief cut in our form so that we can tuck the lips that we split, all that loose skin, inside of here.
Oh, so it like really just, it goes into the form.
Yep. And that's how you get a natural lip line.
Wow.
So now we just want to dig into here so that we can set in our eyes.
So what do we do with the epoxy?
Epoxy. You want to put it on your skin, so I'm going to hand this back to you in a second. You just want to open up your little leg holes, either with the paintbrush or the modeling tool, and just feed. Front legs don't need as much. You can do a little bit more than that. Just so we are adhering our paws onto our form. And then those back ones you saw, there was about like a half inch or so of wiggle room. So we're gonna put a little bit more down there. And because this is it's a clay, we can also just work it down on our form if we put a little too much on there.
So I already have the epoxy in the limbs, got those all filled out, and now we gotta get a wire in the tail. So I'm just gonna take this wire and feed it down to the end, and it came out the end. Okay, so like right there. Is that
wrong? It's okay if it comes out at the end of the tail.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So we got our forms all ready, we got our skins prepped. Now we have our hide paste. So all we're gonna do now is you want to slather on a little bit on your head and on the underside. You're not gonna go anywhere on the back right now. So I'll let you do that.
Okay. Okay, how'd I do?
Yeah, that looks good. So you can start slipping your skin onto the form.
This is so exciting. Where's your other eyeball, buddy? Oh, all right.
Yeah,
there's officially
okay.
glue
that's
everywhere.
Okay.
Around without putting like a hole in it. Whoa, there we go. One eye looks okay. One ear is really messed up.
So we got our skins just loosely on our form. The faces are a little wonky right now, but we're gonna go and tuck everything after we have them sewn up. So we're just gonna use monofilament to sew them up.
Like fishing line.
Yep, fishing line.
Why do we use fishing line?
Because it's thin, clear, and super strong.
So what's the stitch?
We're doing a baseball stitch. So it's like a reverse whip stitch, and I like to go with...
Non-English language.
I like to go from the...
The sailor's knot technique of the roundabout switch up.
So
I guess.
What does it look like?
You stick the needle through the underside of your skin.
Okay.
Either side.
Okay.
And then you just want to go back and forth, putting the needle through the underside of your skin. So it's kind of like lacing shoelaces.
Am I making my incisions too close?
No, you're doing fine.
Okay.
Yeah, it's whatever you're comfortable with for sewing.
Anna, yours is so cute.
Kinda. He kind of looks very scary.
Dude, this is like a scary pose for squirrels. Like, I feel like I kind of want to do one where it's like...
Sitting.
Chewing on something,
yeah.
Like putting an acorn in its mouth or something.
Well, he's getting ready to climb. Something intrigued it and it wants to go down the tree.
Maybe there's a nut at the end of this pose.
Yeah.
So how long does it usually take you to do a steady skin like this?
So skinning and steady skin can take 30 minutes.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
And especially like a squirrel, it can be even like 25.
You just get it all out there and then you just...
Yeah.
Bing,
then it's
bam,
just,
boom.
Yeah.
And we literally spent all day on these guys.
Yes.
From like 9 a.m. set up until 4:30 in the afternoon.
Yeah. 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 It was a... Yeah.
No, but sure. I think they look pretty good.
I think they look amazing. I had really low expectations. So this is like the most incredible thing I've ever done with art in my entire life.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much, Katie,
I'm
for coming.
Thank you.
Guys,
you're totally rad.
You
you're a really great teacher. She's super patient.
Yeah, super patient.
You're awesome.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Awesome. And yeah, good luck with everything with Afterlife Anatomy.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yay.
It still has brains on it.